Hi, I'm Pastor Steve Green, and with me is my wife, Dee.
As we continue to work our way back, we believe the first thing to get back to is prayer.
After 40 years of ministry, we know that prayer changes things.
You're not alone. If you need prayer, call the MTC Christ is Center prayer line.
Or submit your prayer request online, mtcfc.org. Remember, we're here for you, and we've got your back.
Shame is undone.
Well, praise the Lord, everybody. Good Sunday morning. Good S-O-N-D-A-Y-S-U-N-D-A-Y, the sun. The Sunday as I'm under an open heaven. Good Sunday morning. If you're catching this on a Sunday, it's the day that the Lord has made. Let's rejoice and be glad in it. Welcome to another edition of Conquering Your World. I'm Steve Green. I'm the senior pastor of MTC, i.e. More Than Conquerors. More Than Conquerors Faith Church. That's who we are. That's why I'm standing on the beautiful campus here of More Than Conquerors Faith Church. To my immediate right, you can see our beautiful family life center where families experience life just like they did this past Wednesday for the Respect Annual Safe Summer Rally. We're so excited about all that God is doing here on the campus of More Than Conquerors Faith Church, 1327 Denison Avenue, Southwest Birmingham, Alabama. There are a lot of houses that are doing very well, very affluent to my right. Some are work in progress to my left, but we're right in the midst of it, showing them excellence all around on our grounds, letting them know that, you know, though we walk sometimes through the valley of the shadow of death, we ain't ever scared. We fear no evil, for thou art with us. Your rod and your staff, they comfort us. You prepare a table before us in the presence of our enemies. You anoint our head with oil, and you are, our cup runs over. Prosperity. Amen. So we're so excited about it. Happy Memorial Day on this Memorial Day weekend. It's a day for more than just the gateway to the summer, going to theme parks and beaches and, you know, just getting ready to come outside. This day is designed to remember our soldiers, those that died in battle for us. So, you know, as we remember our soldiers, we certainly got to put Jesus in that group, because he's the mighty warrior that died in battle. He gave his life for us. He's a mighty warrior dressed for battle. Holy Lord of all is he. He's the commander in chief. Bring us to attention, attend, as I do it, attend, hut, bring us to attention. Let us, God, have, may we give you our undivided attention. My son, attend to my word. Incline thine ear to my saying, Proverbs says. Let it not depart from your eyes. Keep it in the midst of your heart. For when you give God your undivided attention, it is life to those that find it, health to all their flesh. So, mighty warrior, dressed for battle, Holy Lord of all is he. He's the commander in chief. He's bringing us to attention. Lead us into battle just to crush the enemy. I'm already preaching here. Romans 16:20 says, may the God of peace, the God of calmness and tranquility, may he crush and bruise Satan under your feet. Romans 16:20, when it said, may God crush Satan under your feet. Romans 16:20, under your feet, all those that are part of the Navy and the Marines and have submarines, missiles underwater, they will appreciate that scripture on Memorial Day weekend. May the God of peace crush, pulverize, disintegrate, destroy your enemy under your feet, like a missile is under water. Amen. Well, the word under your feet is the word torpedo, where we get the word torpedo. Now, you know, the Naval Fleet, the Marines, boy, they out on them ships, Naval Fleet, and when they get ready to strike the enemy don't see it coming, because there's a torpedo, it's a missile flowing underwater. It's flowing with the water. It's flowing with the water. And that's why in these days, we must flow with the water of God. As God promises in the last day, he's going to pour out his spirit on all flesh. And our sons, our daughters, those in military, our young men, our old men shall dream dreams. And all of that will just keep us alive. Amen. It'll ultimately call us to be more than conquerors. Somebody say, I don't know about this pulpit thing, PG. As in a little bit, I'm going to thank God for our stakeholders that helped us out Memorial Day weekend to keep our community safe. But this is actually, when you see the word really pulpit, one of the few times you see pulpit in the Bible, it's not even on the inside of the sanctuary. Over in Nehemiah chapter 9, it says when they were coming back from Babylon, Nehemiah got him a pulpit, made a little stage outside
of wood, and they preached the word of God consecutively under the open heavens, under the sun. So this is really a Sunday. As I am doing the Psalm 19 thing, I'm declaring the word of God under an open heaven. The heavens declare his glory as we, I don't want to cause the camera to go back, but if you could just take me out of the picture for a moment and just scan the sky right now. The sky shall behold him under the open heaven. I know we can't look right in the sun, but I'm under the open heavens. The portals are open, and I'm asking God to open the floodgates of heaven. Amen. I heard Pastor Priscina Baldwin, she's a part of that. Well, she pastors Abundant Harvest Church, but I was on my way in listening to one of our stakeholder stations, and she was giving the word Leviticus 26:4 out of some NIV Bible or something, and she says that God said he would send the rain at the right time. Pastor Priscina said, you may have thought you needed it last week, but may God send us the rain just when we need it. So we're asking God, as we're under the open heavens, to declare his glory. Nehemiah took the pulpit, and I think about the word pulpit. Pull is a pit that pulls people up. Pulpit. Amen. We declare the word from this plexiglass and from this pulpit to say it's summertime. Now, before I go any further, I won't be very long today. Let me thank God for the singers and all that went before me declaring the glory of God as we get ready to go into, obviously June, July, August, and be prepared. Don't want to even mention getting ready to go back to school later in September, but we're getting ready for all of that. But today is to celebrate Memorial Day, to challenge your memory, what I call to remind you. I want to remind you. So we're calling this message today continuation, Pentecost season, a sound from heaven, right? You hear the wind blowing as a sub-thought, not only just a sound from heaven, but fighting from the heavens. Fighting from the heavens. There's a lot she'll try to go on in the earth, but we're going to fight from the heavens. Key scripture is going to be Judges chapter 5, verse number 20. In Judges chapter 5, verse number 20, it'll tell us that Deborah, she was one of the judges. You know, we got enough people going before judges, but Deborah was one of the judges, and the Bible says that she began to fight with Barak. That's a form of praise, which means to kneel. And she fought from the heavens. There's a lot of fighting going on. We're fighting for our health, fighting for our sanity, fighting for our children, fighting for our nation, fighting for our finances, our houses, our well-being. And if we're going to win this fight, just as those that fought for our country, it may cost you something. You might be under the heavens. You may be in a Vietnam War, jungle warfare. You may have to go into a place far away from what you used to fight that battle. But I want to tell you that this is a season, from the Christian perspective, that we must do what those judges did. You know, judges, and I'm getting ahead of myself, in the Bible, there's Joshua. There's the book of Judges. And then there's the book of Ruth. Joshua was to take them into the promised land. The United States is one of the greatest countries in America. People are fighting. Immigrants are doing their best to get into the land of the free, the home of the brave. But somebody had to fight to secure these continental United States of America. And we bless and we dare not forget those that have, that bear the marks and the scars in their body. You know, post-traumatic stress disorders, as a result of the fighting, they're still having flashbacks of gunshots and all that happened around them. So in the midst of our barbecue and traveling and beaches, let us not forget those soldiers that put their lives in harm's way. And they fought in the jungles. They fought overseas. But I believe if there's ever been a time that we need to learn how to, in this Pentecost season that promises that God would send something from heaven, right? Acts 2:1-4, it says, when the day of Pentecost was fully come, I know we celebrated that last week, but it says there came a sound from heaven, and it was as a rushing mighty wind. One of the things that we've noticed, Elder Thompson, since we've been doing this recording, is that wind, every about 5 minutes, it just rushed upon us. It started just turning the pages, and I believe every time the wind turned the pages on this Bible, you are about to turn another page in your life. You're about to write another chapter in your life. You're about to write another book in your life. As we're under the open heavens, I hear the sound of a mighty rushing wind. I think those pages are turning now, filling all the house as they were sitting there. You're not under page chapter 7. The wind, I'm not turning those pages. Look at there. The wind is turning prophetically the pages of your life, and look like it's headed toward the back of the book. Look like the wind is blowing it toward the book of Revelations until you get to the end of the book. I couldn't have staged that. It just happened. The late, great Dwayne Davis said, Pastor Green, he said, man, you're so awesome. And I'm gonna just put that out of the way now. He said, you're so awesome, you'll get grits, a message out of grits. So there we have it. Didn't plan to do it. That's the sound there that we're hearing, you know, as we're talking from a topic, right? Pentecost season, Acts 2:1-4, fighting from the heavens, Judges 5:20. And we got to remind you, Psalm 103. I want to remind you, cause you to remember. I want to remind you of those that fought for this country. But at the same time, I'm reminding you, I want to remind, I want to put another mind in you. Let this mind, I want to remind you. You used to think right, but I want to remind you on this Memorial Day of what God said he would do for you. Amen. So just as we have the Bible there turning pages, what a prophetic picture. That's as we're under the open heaven, under an open heaven, just as the scripture says, there was a sound in Acts 2:1 when Pentecost was fully come. And there was a sound as a rushing mighty wind filled all the house as they were sitting there. And it says, and they all began to speak in unknown tongues. And when they got filled with the Holy Ghost, they would be able to fulfill, they would come to a place where everything God said about them would be fulfilled. It will come to pass. So he told them in Acts 1:8, after the Holy Ghost has come upon you, Pentecost season, which is a summer. They just celebrated that a couple of weeks ago globally. It's the fourth of God's feasts. Memorial Day is not one of them. In the Jewish calendar, you know, unleavened bread, Passover, right? First fruits. When Jesus was the first fruits of them that slept, he got up. That fourth feast is what we're in the midst of now. Pentecost. It's that time of harvest. But the enemy would love to do everything he can to dry your harvest up. But I remind you of what Matthew 9 says, pray that the Lord of the harvest would send forth laborers to reap the harvest. Now what he said in Matthew 35:38, Jesus was literally at a place where he was beholding the sheep, and they were having a summer-like negative effect. They were fainting. They were like sheep scattered, fainting. You know, they needed food. And so he went on to say that the harvest is plentiful. I'm talking about what God wants for you while you're playing and traveling this summer. Don't forget about your harvest. The harvest is truly plentiful, or plenteous, but the laborers are few. He said, pray to the Lord of the harvest that he would send forth laborers. There are restaurants, business, church workers. We don't know as things begin to open. We believe that somewhere in July we will have our reopening, and those of you will come and partake and walk through the doors and enter into his gates with thanksgiving. We believe that's going to happen. But in the meantime, we're asking God that when we do, that you won't get so comfortable that we realize that we need some warriors, we need some fighters, that we will pray that the Lord of the harvest would send forth laborers to reap this end time harvest. If there's ever been a time where we needed the body of Christ to rise up to the occasion, we need to do that because we need to remind the people. Do you not realize, my beloved, that during this last year, I hear it so much on the national news, local news, sports world, people saying, man, this last year just took something out of my soul, out of my mind. That's why I want to remind you, right? Yes, I almost lost some. Said, man, I just, you know, between the effects of COVID and my job loss and the pressure on my children, me trying to teach them and be a teacher, I almost lost my mind. I was fighting for my very sanity. Well, that's why I want to remind you or renew your mind. I therefore, brethren, beseech you that you present your body just like the soldiers did in all those previous wars. They drafted, some volunteered. Present your body as a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable unto God, which is your reasonable, rational service. It says that you not be conformed to this world, but you be transformed by the renewing of your mind, the memory, that you not forget. Not only that you not forget those soldiers that fought for you to live in this great country, the land of opportunity, but that you also not forget Jesus Christ, who died, that came that you might have life. And Romans 6:4 says that you might walk in the newness of life, making everything new. Amen. So many have been at a place of panic attacks, anxious. I mean, you know, they're just careful. Their souls are weary. This is why the psalmist says, the Lord is my light, in chapter 27, and my salvation. Whom shall I fear? The Lord is the strength of my life. Of whom shall I be afraid? When the wicked, even my enemies and my flesh, came upon me, my enemies and my foes came upon me to eat up my flesh, to consume it. Because sometimes the enemy tries to consume our flesh with sickness, desire, with disease. He came to eat up my flesh. They stumble and they fail, though an host should encamp. This Memorial Day, you ask the average soldier that fought in any war, what it's like where you're camping out, you know, don't know what your next assignment, and all of a sudden rounds start dropping around you and look like the enemy just got you. That's an host encamp against you. Maybe you don't have that because you've not been to a natural war, but when you look at your life, it looked like you are just surrounding. Kind of remind me of two passages. One, when Elisha in 2 Kings chapter 5 and 6, Elisha, E-L-I-S-H-A, he went out to battle, he and his servant, and they began to do, Elder Thompson, almost a panoramic view. I'll go as far as I can. They almost did a 360, and they looked around every direction they went. They said, alas, my master, you could guide me if I get out of range here to tell me when I need to stop. He said, alas, my master. He started looking all around him, all points above, below. He says, what shall we do, my master? He said, look like they that are against us is more than they that are for us. A whole host was coming against them. And I won't go the complete that the direction that way, but they were surrounded in 2 Corinthians. And what Elisha prayed for his understudy is that God would open his eyes. He said, open his eyes that the young man may see that there were around those mountains, there was chariots of fire. And God, open the young man's eyes. That's my prayer for you today, as you may be surrounded by a host, a plethora of things that are coming against you and vices that are coming against you. You're completely surrounded. But in the name of Jesus today, I cease not to make mention of you in my prayer, that the God of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of glory, may give unto you a spirit of wisdom, revelation, and the knowledge of him, that the eyes of your understanding may be enlightened, that you may know what is the hope of his calling, and what is the riches of the glory of his inheritance in his saints, and what is the exceeding greatness of his power to us who believe, and what is that mighty power that he wrought in Christ Jesus when he raised him from the dead spirit far above all principality, all power, all might, all authority, and gave him to be head of the church. Now there's one place where a whole host was coming against him, but the prophet saw something different. Pastor, what do you see over the next 3 months? Can I tell you why I'm under these open heavens? What I see? I see the Son of Righteousness, Malachi chapter 4, S-U-N. I see the Son of Righteousness to those of you that fear my name. Right? Malachi 4:2. For those that worship me, he says, that fear my name shall the Son of Righteousness. I'm not talking about the Son that we can point the camera up in the sky. We'll go that far. But the Son of Righteousness shall rise with healing. I believe these next 3 months will be the continuation of the healing of the nations. That's what Revelation says in chapter 22, that I saw a river in the midst of the street. And that was a that I saw trees on both sides and a river flow while they were outside, almost like if this was a river and there was trees on the left and there was trees on the right, and the river was in between them, the river of Pentecost, the Ezekiel river. And he say those rivers were for the healing of the nations. I see over the next 3 months that the nations will continue to be healed. I pray for India, not just America. I pray for China and the World Games in Birmingham, the Olympics over the summer, and the respect rallies, and all your trips, family reunions, and all of your boating, all of the things that you do to travel, your staycations, vacation, park experience. I see God being a protection and the shield, that God surrounding you with the shield of faith, the Son of Righteousness rising with healing. May he heal the nations. The leaves on the trees, Revelation says in 22, is for the healing of the nation. The river that's flowing out of my belly, as I'm not even looking at notes, is for the healing of the nations. When you look up nations, you'll see the word geneo, where we get the word your genes, for the generation. So the Son of Righteousness, the river that's flowing, John 7, is for the healing of the nations, not just international, but internation, that nation that's on the inside of you. Yes, may God give you a river of life, just as there will be in Revelation 22, when you are surrounded by the enemy. But not only that, we also see, as I've tucked my Bible away, just as our soldiers have gone to war, very few civil wars and international wars have taken place on the soil of the United States. Most of our battles were being fought other places, right? Bombs, the Hiroshima, and all kind of places, Normandy, France, those kind of places. You know the story of the historicity of the United States of America. Amen. But there have been some civil wars. But it's important that we understand that sometimes the enemy looks like he got you surrounded, like he did in Exhibit A, Elisha and the servant. Now, Exhibit B, the second case where it looks like we are surrounded. When we are surrounded, we need the heavens to be open. If you would notice, I mean, the rivers are flowing as I'm under these open heavens, that in 2 Corinthians, Paul is writing to Corinth. It's a country. Here's what he writes to them. And boy, they have problems in Corinthians. He writes to them because in 2 Corinthians chapter 1, verses 3 and 4, he said they had the sentence of death. Somebody had written a sentence of death over them. I was listening to one of the, as the NBA are playing sports, one of the coaches looked at another other team. It was the Brooklyn Nets. The Boston Celtics coaches looked at the other team, and he almost said what them other 10 spies that came back. He said, they'll be giants. He says, it's going to take a whole lot. He says, I don't even know if we can even beat them at all, like grasshoppers. And they had great debates about whether or not he should be telling his team that the other team looked like they've already won the battle before the fight in the game ever got started. That's the way it looks sometimes. And host Psalm 27 encamps against you. War rises against you, Psalm 27. But it says, in this will I be confident. Now, I can go toward a new term they're using in the world, especially in the sports world, sometimes in the political world. They'll look at somebody that just think they're all that, don't have none of the skills, none of the anointing, no reason why they would think that they would win. And they call that state of mind irrational confidence. Irrational confidence. Well, there's a place where even though, you know, we should not be winning, two fish, five loaves, how are you going to feed 5,000? An issue of blood for 12 years, 18 years, 38 years at the man sitting to my far right at the pool called Bethesda. You know, that's what that Family Life Center is about, the Bethesda Family Life Center, so that when you come on these holy grounds, we expect those that have been sitting in the places of defeat, come on somebody, or unexpectation, even if it's been 38 years over to my left there, to be made whole. It was said there were those on this Memorial Day weekend that sat at the pool of Bethesda. Some were blind. Some were lame. Some were halt. I mean, they just stopped, wasn't moving. Some were withering. But the angel of the Lord at certain seasons, like Pentecost season, would stir the waters and ask them what I'm asking you on this Memorial Day as I remind you that your battle has already been won. He asked them, will you be made whole? All those, yes. Well, you can be made whole, but you got to do a series of things. 1 Thessalonians 5 says, you got to rejoice evermore. You can't just rejoice when you go on vacation. You got to pray without ceasing. In everything, you got to give God thanks. For this is the will of God in Christ Jesus concerning you. You got to quench not the spirit, whether you're on the inside or the outside. You got to abstain and shun the very appearance of evil. Make sure you're at the right place, right time, not out at 3 o'clock in the morning. Nothing good generally happens after midnight. Then it goes on to say, and the very God of peace sanctify you wholly, W-H-O-L-Y-L-L-Y, and may he preserve you this summer. Back in the day, my grandmother, they would pick fruits, and all the fruit we couldn't eat immediately, they would can them and call them preserves. I'm praying that you'll have a summer overflow, that the summer fruit would be so great that you'll have to preserve the rest of them. May God preserve your, First Thessalonians 5 says in verse 23, may he preserve your whole, W-H-O-L-E, spirit, soul, and body. And verse 24 says, faithful is he who's calling you, and he will do it. Now, that second exhibit was over there in 2 Corinthians, where God had told them they had the sentence of death over them. That in 2 Corinthians 1, 7 and 8, he says, we will not have you to be ignorant, brethren, concerning the things that happened to us while we were over in Asia. I understand that, you know, CDC and all those are beginning to open up places in Asia and Europe, so I might as well, while I'm in that place, if you have any trips to the Orient, to Asia or to Europe or Rome, wherever you're going, may God cover you. He says, we got in trouble while we were there. But it says, but God delivered us. He said, the God that delivered doth deliver, that's it, and will yet. Three forms that God will always deliver. But what he went on to say to them, exhibit A of when you're surrounded was Elijah. Exhibit B is in 2 Corinthians chapter 4 to the Corinth. He says, now we are troubled on every side. I step to the right side, trouble. And that look like our society? Look in the political world. We look in the church world. We look in the athletic world. We look in the financial world. We'll trouble on every side, just like soldiers were in battle and made it back alive. Some died. Some of the on Veterans Day, you know, they're celebrating those that are alive, and even some that are dead. But on Memorial Day, we are remembering those that died. Well, you could have, would have, and should have died. Well, your life could have died. Your children could have died, accident, whatever, last year. But God kept you alive. He says, but God, it says over in 2 Corinthians, if our gospel be hid, is hid to those that are lost, in whom the God of this world hath blinded the minds. Hath blinded the minds. You know, natural blindness, not to be able to see. You know, I can look at that sun and it's blinding. You have to get your eyes back. You have to refocus. But the worst kind of blindness It's your mind blindness. Nobody teaches us about mind blindness, glaucoma of the mind, cataracts of the mind, double vision of the mind, myopia of the mind, nearsightedness and farsightedness of the mind. But he says in Corinthians, in whom the God of this world, Satan, the God of this world system, telling you, you ain't getting nothing out. No job for you, no house for you, no life for you. You stuck in a bad community. The God of this world, I want to remind you, he hath blinded the minds, the thoughts, right? He's blinded the minds of those that believe not, lest the light of this glorious gospel, the light, we're under the light. God said, let there be light, should shine just like the sun is shining, to give light of the knowledge of the glory of God in the face of Jesus. So may God remove every blinder off your mind, and may he remind you what the warrior, that mighty warrior, did for you. Satan hath blinded the minds of those that believe not, lest the light of this glorious gospel should shine. God, who commanded the light to shine out of darkness, has now shone into our hearts to give the light, it's daylight, of the knowledge of the glory of God in the face of Jesus. And we have this treasure in earthen vessels, that the excellency of the power may be of God and not of us. Now, we need that light for what? He says, while we are troubled on every side, surrounded. Elder Thompson, you are always not too far away. I can only imagine to be out there in warfare in the middle of a desert, a desert sand, desert storm. You know, I was talking to one of our military guys, Escott, and I saw him in a shopping store recently. And he said, Pastor, I was out, man, overseas, and boy, rounds were going off every day. He said, I just got back, but things were going off all around us. But in the name of Jesus, you know, as those things were going off, God brought him back. He did not die, because we always pray for our military leaders. We put red ribbons like we gave on Wednesday to the whole community. If you go overseas and you're surrounded, if you go on college campuses and the enemy is surrounding you with things that your parents and your pastor did not teach you, or that you did not teach, we're praying that God will bring you back home alive from college, that God will bring you back home alive from wherever your vacation is. That's what we're praying, that God will keep you alive. So it says, while we are troubled on every side, we're surrounded like Elijah, Exhibit A, but we're not distressed. We are perplexed, but we're not in despair. Persecuted, hard driven, yes, but we are not destroyed. Cast down, but we're not struck out. So we're excited about all that God is doing. And as you can hear there, I'm under the open heavens on the major thoroughfare, and you can hear the trucks passing even as I go, but I'm enjoying all of this, seeing all this passing by me. So though we're troubled, we're not distressed. Amen. We're surrounded. That's what Psalm 27, what David meant when he says, the Lord is my light and my salvation, whom shall I fear? Though an host should encamp against me, though war should rise against me, in this will I be confident. Not irrational confident. This is strong confidence, right? Not irrational confidence. But Proverbs 14:26 says, in the fear of the Lord, there is strong confidence. It tells us in Hebrews 10:35, don't you cast away your confidence. 1 John 5:14 says, and this is the confidence that we have in him, that if we ask anything according to his will, he heareth us. So God's got us surrounded because I am a soldier in the army of the Lord. And the reason the enemy can't take you out yet is because you've sold out. You're enduring hardness as a good soldier. You ask some of our warriors and soldiers that that died in battle, man, they had to fight a good fight. So we're calling this fighting from the heavens. We must learn how to fight from the heavens. Now let me shift it, as I've obviously talked about Acts chapter 2, Pentecost, the season of Pentecost, where we get a sound from heaven. We talked about Judges chapter 5, where God raised up all these judges, book of Joshua, when Joshua would go into battle. You know the story. And before they went into battle, before Joshua shouted the walls down, you got to know who your captain is. They get to chapter 5. They're getting ready to go over into the land. They've already crossed the Jordan River. But then in Joshua 5:13, there's a theophany. Theo means to God. Phanel is like movie, a picture, a show. God shows up. Jesus shows up as the incarnate, but as a theophany. He appeared. And Joshua looked at him because Joshua was a soldier himself, remember? You're talking about a warrior on Memorial Day. Joshua was a soldier himself. And Joshua looks up at Jesus, the captain of the army, right? Joshua was just in the squad. You know that Joshua is a soldier, right? Exodus 17. He knew Jehovah Nissi, the one that wins the battle. Moses is upon the hill fighting. Moses get tired. They sit Moses down. They literally kind of sit him. He takes a sit down on the rock. They put his hands up, one on the left, one on the right. And as long as his hands were lifted up, he won the battle. That's Torah. Why don't you get both hands up now? As long as his hands were lifted up on the top of the hill, and we ain't talking about Capitol Hill now, on the top of the hill, Moses. But at the bottom, at the foot of the hill, Joshua was at the foot of the hill. He was making sure the orders were being carried out, just like Elder Thompson does at Morning Conquerors, right? And they named that place Jehovah Nissi, what I'm naming this summer for you, the place where you win the battle, where you don't get tired, where you don't faint, where you don't get weary, where the sun shall not smite you physically, financially, emotionally, you know what I'm saying? In no kind of way shall the sun smite you. Sun strokes you. Amen. The sun will not smite you when you say the third psalm of the ascent. I will lift up mine eyes into the hills. Joshua saw Moses on the hill. You see Jesus on the hill. From which cometh my help? My help comes from the Lord. The Lord that made the heavens and the earth, even if I were going to building. He made both of them. The heavens declare his glory. The firmament show forth his handiwork, what he's working on. I will lift up mine eyes into the hills from which cometh my help. My help coming from the Lord, the God that made heaven and earth. He says, the God that neither slumbers nor sleeps. He that keepeth Israel, there the word of the Lord is. Yes, Israel has been in battle, bombs going on around. But I'm praying right now, Psalms 122 would say, pray for the peace of Israel. Brenda Jones, I know you love this. We're praying because God has always kept Israel, no matter what came against them. And may God continue to keep Israel, for Israel is to God what you are to God. Zechariah 2:8, that's the apple of God's eye. So may God keep Israel. Right? He that keepeth Israel, Psalms 121, also keeps you this summer. Keep your children, Keilat's children, while they're at theme parks. May the Lord be a keeper. May the Lord bless you. May the Lord keep you. Right? Numbers 6:34, the Lord keep you. Psalm 121, the Lord, he that keepeth Israel shall also keep you. And it says, the sun shall not smite you by day, nor the moon by night. Amen. The Lord shall both preserve your going out and coming in. You'll go out and you'll come back in. Blessed in the field, blessed in the city. So this Joshua thing, and we'll end back over there in 2 Corinthians. I end with Psalm 103, that last phase of fighting from the heavens, right? So we see there that Joshua is a military man. So he knows how to fight with natural weapons. But we're fighting from the heavens. So this time when Joshua, when he was fighting for Moses, listen to me. When Joshua in Exodus 17 was fighting for Moses, he was using natural swords. But Moses never made it in. That's Exodus 17. But when you get to the book of Joshua, when Joshua becomes the leader, he's not fighting with natural weapons. He's fighting from the heavens. Guess what happens? Joshua 5:13. They've crossed over the Jordan River. They've taken the Ark of the Covenant. Now what he's doing, everybody is just walking around. They're walking around outside. They're not in the temple. No temple has been built yet. They're outside walking around a fortress, a city. They did it. They just walked around. They did it one time. They did that thing seven times. If I were to do this seven times, they did it, you know, on the second day. Then they did it again on the, not on the second day, but they made another lap and they did a third day. And you know, when they kept on going around it, they did it three times. Somebody said, "You making me dizzy." Well, imagine them walking around this building. They did it a fourth time, then a fifth time, then a sixth. But on the seventh day, Joshua pulled out a weapon because he looked up and said, "Jesus, are you for us or for our adversary?" And Jesus says, "Look, I'm not neither for you nor your adversary. I just got a sword drawn. How do I activate it?" Well, what Joshua did was took out a spiritual weapon. He got the people to march around outside. And when they did that, they shouted, and the walls came tumbling down. It would almost be as if, and God forbid, this would ever be destroyed, amen. But if it was a demolition of some sort because we were going to build something 20 times better, that would be the only reason, God, not by tornado or hurricane or anything else, shall it, and your house shall not be. But a shout would take you into another structure. So Joshua, the commandant leader there, military leader, the warrior, the soldier, used to winning battles. He said, "This one here, to get in that first city, this is going to take a shout." As we go, this is the first weekend to the gateway of summer. I want you to get ready to give God a shout offering. I know you fought many times. You fought with your resume. You fought with your medication. You fought with your skills. And you fought with your contacts and all of your connections. But this one is going to be a Joshua shout, amen, that you're going to fight from the heavens. You haven't forgotten how to do that, have you? Okay, I'm getting ready to close this thing out. Now, I've talked about an Acts chapter 2 Pentecost season, the beginning of the summer harvest. I've talked about judges fighting from the heavens, and I showed how even in Corinthians they had to learn how to fight, for the weapons of our warfare are not carnal, but they're mighty through God to the pulling down of strongholds. That's exactly what Joshua did when they shouted and they went in, right? First fruits. And then the last scripture I gave, and I'm through, is out of Psalm 103, to remind you how to fight. Now, what do you mean remind you? Somebody said that one of the reasons that music is so important, that music is tied into memory. A lot of times when you see music, you'll see memory. That's why they'll put words to song. If they ever put words to song, that's why the rappers, man, they got brilliant mind. You put a little beat with it, and they'll say more in one song than some preachers say in 5 years, because there's a correlation between music and memory. If you want God to really remember you, then you give him a praise. Put the psalm. The psalm is nothing more than hard times to music. But not only hard times, but excellence to music. Right? Hard times, like Psalm 3. That was a song. Psalm or a song. What did the song or psalm say? "Lord, how are they increased that trouble me? Many there be that rise against me. Many there be which say of my soul, there is no help for him in God. But thou, O Lord, art a shield for me." You got me. You're my shield. You got me surrounded. You're my shield of faith. Music and memory go together. Right? It says, "But I will not be afraid of 10,000 that have set themselves against me round about. Save, O Lord. Smite my enemies on the cheekbone." So music to sometimes hard times, Psalm 3. But he also put music, a psalm or a song, to the excellence and supremacy and the reign of God. He writes a song so you can remember this musically. What does he say in Psalm 8? "O Lord, our Lord, how excellent is thy name in all the earth, who has set thy glory above the heavens." You will not teach that on the inside. That's one thing, because you can't see the heavens, but a little panning of the sky. Your name is a household name under the heavens. You set your glory above the heavens, that out of the mouth of babes and sucklings you've ordained strength because of your enemy. What is man that thou art mindful, son of man, that you would visit? Men of you are going on trips to family and loved ones, and you going on visitation. But Job 10:12 says, "God's visitation shall preserve you." Luke chapter 19 says, because Israel did not know the time of their visitation when Jesus was visiting them. Therefore, he said there would be great destruction even among their children. So we'll know when God is visiting us. So the psalm that he put to memory on this Memorial Day, so that you as a soldier in the arm of God don't have to die in battle, is Psalm 8. But we'll put both of those together and we'll end with this on this Memorial Day weekend. We're going to fight from the heavens. We're going to end with a shout, and the walls are coming down. And you're going to go into July, June, July, August for the next 3 months for God to do what he's called you to do. And when it's said and done, the next soldiers' celebration will be Veterans Day. You got a little, victories under your belt. A veteran is an alive soldier. He's inveterate. He's been there for a while. He's skilled. He's seen that before. But Psalm 103 is what I want to remind you. I want to put this in your mind and take all the other things out of your mind as a soldier. All of the post-traumatic stress of what you lost, what the enemy stole, and what the enemy's trying to do. Psalm 103 say, bless the Lord, oh my soul, and forget not. Okay, if I don't forget, that's my memory. Let me remind you, don't forget all his benefits. This is the reminding. What are the benefits that on this Memorial Day that you cannot afford to forget, right? It tells us in Proverbs, the memory of the just is blessed. Holy Ghost bringing all things to your memory. Over in Proverbs 10:7, the memory of the just is blessed. What is it, PG, that I need to remember no matter what I do this weekend? Because I'm a soldier and I don't want to be dying. I don't want nobody next year to have to go to my grave like they're going to those that we're remembering on this holiday. You're going to forget not all his benefits. Number one, he forgives. This is what I want to put back in your mind. You are forgiven of all your iniquities. Number two, he forgives us of all our iniquities. He heals us of all of our diseases. He crowns us with his loving kindness, number three, and tender mercies. He satisfies our mouth with good things. The Amplified Bible says, in our personal situation and at our personal age, he satisfies our mouth with good things, our desires and our needs. He meets our needs this summer. And not only that, which you cannot afford to forget, my God, he renews your youth like an eagle. He renews your youth like an eagle. That's what he does. Amen. And all these things are so, and he redeems your life from the destruction or from the pit. Your life. I'm asking God today, on this day where we're celebrating soldiers that died, we're celebrating the death of those that died, we're remembering the death. I'm asking the Spirit of God that he would give you life, that you would remember the life. And the way you get new life is they overcame by the blood of the Lamb and by the word of their testimony. And all the people of God that said, God is not unrighteous, that you have not forgotten. Hebrews 6:10 says, God is not unrighteous to forget your labor of love and how you have ministered toward the saints and toward his name and do minister. I pray that this will put you in a place where you have been refreshed and renewed in your mind and you're getting ready for the second half. July is not here. We got one more month of June before we go into the second half. But I'm asking the captain of our salvation, Jesus Christ, to appear, to show up and let you know that every battle that you are fighting, even though the enemy looked like he may have you captured, may God turn your captivity this summer and let you know that this year is not over. It's just beginning. So let me pray for you right now. Father, I bless you for the people of God wherever they are. I plead the blood of Jesus that they will have safe summers. I speak Song of Solomon chapter 8, that they will know that love is stronger than death. Jealousy more cruel than the grave. In other words, your love for us is stronger than the death that would try to kill us in any form. And your jealousy / your zeal for you and over us, may it perform this, God. Dear God, and may it keep us in Jesus' name. And may you give us an anointing to do what we need to do during this pandemic. Pentecostal season. And all the people of God said amen. Now, right before the singers come, I want you to just get, you know, a shout, what I call a shout seed out. Some of you, it's tithing time for you. You may be on vacation, but you don't want to go into the summer season, Pentecost season. It's first fruits. It's harvest time, right? You're getting ready. You just came out of the feast, right? Unleavened bread, Passover. Then there was first fruits, and then the Pentecost. So since Pentecost was to suggest your first harvest in the fall, it would be called the ingathering. You should have twice as much of what you need. So get that seed in the house, in your hand, and get it into the house. And, you know, all the things that we gave away, we're only able to give those things away because somebody gave them to us. But especially MTC, get the seed in your hand. Get ready to give. 73256, 73256. Text that in, drop that by, you know what I'm saying? If you're out of town, when you get back, make sure you bring your tithes and your offerings here, and we'll keep on doing greater things as we get ready for Children's Week in the summer, as we get ready for the men's conference June up in the summer of June, as we get ready for the church anniversary and everything that perfects you and everything that concerns you. Again, as I close, as you're getting that tithe, and I'm praying for those that have accepted Jesus as Lord and those that have forgotten how important it is that they remember God all summer long, that you don't put God on a vacation on Sundays, that you remember that Sabbath day like you remember Memorial Day, and you keep that day holy every Sunday. Now, you may go on vacation on a Sunday, but don't take the whole summer off without remembering God and getting renewed. Now, thank you again to all of our stakeholders. Safe summer, rally, respect, ceasefire. Many came out. Hundreds came out. Giveaways were given. Bikes, helmets, all kind of things. Movie passes, splash pass. Floaters were given away. All our stakeholders, Summit Media, thank you very much. 95.7 Jams, WAGG, Kiss FM, thank you very much. Jefferson County Sheriff's Department, Mark Petway, Elder Thompson, over the chaplains, chaplain, Pastor Thompson, and all the chaplains. Jefferson County Commissioner Sheila Tyson, Jefferson County Department of Health, thank you very much, giving us information on vaccination. City Council person, Crystal Smitherman, and of course your parents always help out, Senator Smitherman and Carol Smitherman, judge there, thank you for helping out. Birmingham Parks and Recreation, Division of Youth Services, Gavin Billup, Birmingham Fire and Rescue, just a cast of American Red Cross, the whole village, and More Than Conquerors Faith Church, elders, deacons, respect board, all of you that realize it's important that Ephesians 6:8 says, whatever we do to make happen for others, God will make happen for us. So have a safe summer. Remember, Proverbs says, the name of the Lord in 18 and 10 is a strong tower. Just that name is a strong tower. And the righteous run into that name, and they are safe. Amen. May the Lord bless you, keep you, make his face to shine upon you. You know, be gracious to you, give you peace, and lift his countenance upon you and write his name above your name. In Jesus' name is our prayer. Make sure you tune in again this coming Wednesday. It's going to be a first throne room prayer, fasting and prayer as we go into June. So do not miss praying and fasting this coming Wednesday. There'll be a word from the Lord. God bless you.